Thank you, Brian, for recentering us. That's good. I invite you to stand and join in our gathering hymn. We sing together, "O Jesus, I Have Promised." The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Please be seated. Welcome to worship this day. We gather in this time after Pentecost, but I want to lift up in particular that the gospel readings and the biblical readings in general lead us into a focus on discipleship, what it means to follow Jesus. And so I invite you to have that focus, that mindset this day. And in the coming weeks, there's invitation to reflect on what it looks like to follow Jesus in this world. And if we wonder that the world might be a difficult place to follow Jesus, a place filled with injustice or things that aren't easy for the church to figure out, well, guess what? The Gospel of Luke has much to say about exactly this thing. The disciples not always understanding, but Jesus leading them on, setting his face towards Jerusalem, and teaching what it means to be a follower of Jesus in the process. So invite you again into that focus on discipleship as we worship together this day. We continue with the Kyrie.
Peace in the world. Let us pray. God of hope, you call us to follow you, trusting that what seems impossible might come to fruition in you. Give us hearts full of faith and the persistence to journey on when the road takes us to unfamiliar places. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen. The first book of Kings. When the Lord said to Elijah, "Go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. When you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael as king over Aram. Also, you should anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, as king over Israel. And you shall anoint Elisha, son of Shehab of Abel-Maholah, a prophet in your place." So he set out from there and found Elisha, son of Shehab, who was plowing. There were 12 yoke of oxen ahead of him, and he was with the 12th. Elijah said to pass by him and threw his mantle over him. He left the oxen, ran after Elijah, and said, "Let me kiss my father and my mother, and then I will follow you." Then Elijah said to him, "Go back again, for what have I done to you?" He returned from following him, took the yoke of oxen, and slaughtered them. Using the equipment from the oxen, he boiled their flesh and gave it to the people, and they ate. Then he set out and followed Elijah and became his servant. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Join me in the responsive reading from Psalm 16. Protect me, Lord, for I take refuge in you. I have said to the Lord, "You are my Lord, my good above all others."
O Lord, you are my portion and my cup. It is you who uphold my lot.
My boundaries enclose the pleasant land. Indeed, I have a rich inheritance.
I will bless the Lord who gives me counsel. My heart teaches me night after night.
I have set the Lord always before me. Because God is at my right hand, I shall not be shaken.
My heart, therefore, is glad, and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope.
For you will not abandon me to the grave, nor let your Holy One see the pit.
You will show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore.
Please stand.
The Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When the days drew near for Jesus to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem, and he sent messengers ahead of him. On their way, they entered a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him, but they did not receive him because his face was set toward Jerusalem. When his disciples, James and John, saw it, they said, "Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them?" But he turned and rebuked them. Then they went on to another village. As they were going along the road, someone said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." To another he said, "Follow me." But he said, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." But Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Another said, I will follow you, Lord, but let me first say farewell to those at my home. Jesus said to him, no one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Grace and peace to you from the God who turns swords into plowshares and from Christ who teaches us to love our enemies. Amen. On their way to Jerusalem, Jesus and his disciples entered a village, but they did not receive him. When his disciples James and John saw it, they said, Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them? But Jesus turned and rebuked them. Then they went on to another village. Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them? Because there are times, Lord, when I feel this is what they deserve. There are times when in grief and in anger, my troubled soul feels that all is lost. Insurrection at the Capitol. Violence against black bodies in the streets. Poverty on reservation lands. Guns in our schools. My heart is bitter. And Lord, I am scared. How do we live together in a land where the highest courts protect the wicked and the wealthy and leave pregnant women to fend for themselves? I chose to follow you, Lord, on a beautiful day, on a day by the lakeside. I chose to follow you because you fill the nets of the needy and give an abundance of bread to all who hunger. I chose to follow you for the beauty and for the peace, and most of all, for the hope. I did not come looking for you to lead me to the new Sodom and Gomorrah. I did not come to see your body beaten and spat upon and lynched upon a tree. Why? Why do you insist on leading us all to Jerusalem? Why should we go to the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it? The feeling of despair is deep in me, Lord. I can no longer see the beauty of that day when you called me by the lakeside. I see only the wickedness of men who show no compassion. Men who have no love or respect for your justice. Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them? On Friday morning, I heard the news that the Supreme Court overturned Roe versus Wade. Suddenly, a law that has protected the bodies of pregnant women since before my own birth has been cast aside. The leaked reports were true. Our courts are not safeguarding the lives of the vulnerable. They are exposing the vulnerable to a world that cares neither for compassion nor for justice. I sit and I think to myself that this news, this decision comes on the heels of the Juneteenth holiday, celebration of emancipation. It comes in the month when we are celebrating pride. Black bodies, gay and trans bodies, women's bodies, our nation is casting them all aside. Where, O God, is their compassion? Where, O God, is their love for justice? Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and to consume them? That mention of fire from heaven, it's a reminder of the biblical story of Sodom and Gomorrah. Americans often associate the word Sodom with the act of gay sex and laws that condemn it. Many assume that when God rains sulfur and fire upon Sodom and Gomorrah, that this is some kind of punishment for the gay sex that God supposedly abhors. But if you read the Bible, you will find that the sin of Sodom is not gay sex. The sin of Sodom is preying upon the poor and the needy, not showing compassion, not protecting the vulnerable. God does not despise pride parades or love in its many forms. God abhors powerful men who seek to control and abuse the vulnerable. God is angered by councils and courts that expose women and refugees in their time of need, that cast them aside into the streets. Here is what the prophet Ezekiel says about this sin in Sodom that caused fire to rain from heaven. The prophet says, "This was the guilt of your sister Sodom. She and her daughters had pride, excess of food, and they had prosperous ease. But they did not aid the poor and the needy. They did not aid the poor and the needy." This is the sin that angers God so, that God despises: the powerful preying upon the weak, the privileged showing no compassion for those in need. The disciples are right. They're right to see this village that rejects them as filled with sin, to make that connection with the sin of Sodom. And all who cry out against America for its failure to show mercy, for its deep lack of compassion, they are also right. God hates injustice. God despises cities and nations that callously turn away from people in their hour of need. As my own heart trembles with anger, I remember the tiny body that I held in my own hands. The grief that filled the room was inevitable. It was a grief that could not be avoided. There was no reality in which this child would not die. No doctor had the power to heal him. No judge, no politician could make him well. His mother was 17 years old. She was not prepared to be a mother, and far less to bury a child. Called in as the hospital chaplain, I met with her when her child was yet living inside of her. I came alongside her in the moments after she learned that her unborn child was gravely, deathly ill. Whether or not inducing labor to end the pregnancy would be considered an abortion did not occur to me. But the question weighs on my mind today, and I know this day what I want to be true. I want to live in a world where we don't pretend to control things that are beyond our control, and where in all things, in all times, in all circumstances, we surround the vulnerable, the suffering, the hurting with compassion and with love. I am pro-choice because my faith teaches me to love and honor the bodies of my neighbors, not crucify them on the altars of morality or of religion. When Jesus set his face to Jerusalem and had the courage to go to the cross, He showed us that suffering and death cannot always be avoided. These are things that we do not control, forces that are beyond us. For a pregnant woman or for an unborn child, suffering and death cannot always be avoided. Again and again, Christ calls us to surrender our illusions of control and instead to focus fully on God's call to live lives of compassion, to be a people of justice. Even when our hearts ache with the desire to simply burn this world down, Christ calls us to let go of those things we cannot control and to join him in God's sacrificial work, to journey with him to places of compassion, to places of justice. Thinking on that 17-year-old whose pregnancy was ended early, and thinking about that child who died, I remember the sacrificial work of compassion in that room. She was not alone. There were skilled nurses who watched over her, who worked to guard life and to ease pain. They did not have the power to save, to prevent death, but they did have the power to love. And what they gave is what they could. They gave with a tenderness and a love that in fact gave me glimpses of life beyond the grave. The delivery itself was not physically difficult. Inducing to abort the pregnancy early meant that this child was still so very small. There were no screams or cries from the mother, only soft sobs, only murmurs of sorrow. And after the child was delivered, there were no cries, there were no sounds of life at all. There were only the soft sounds of these skilled and reverent nurses who understood that this space was holy space. When the nurses carefully placed the child's body in my hands, no breath of life remained. He was warm to the touch, but he did not move. And holding his fragile body, in that moment, I had no illusions of control. The reality of pregnancy, and of abortion, and of all bodily things is always more mysterious and messy than we imagine them to be. This room was so very far from the courts where judges rule or from those halls where politicians debate. Being so close to this teenage mother and her aborted child, I was cleansed from any urge to judge or to condemn. The only thing I felt was the holiness of being in such a fragile space. If ever I will know what it was like for Jesus' mother to stand near the cross, then for me it was in a moment such as this. I think of these things and I am drawn back to that cross where Jesus died. And to my surprise, I find that my deep despair and my desire to burn this world to the ground, those things begin to fade. The nearer I am to the cross, the more tenderness and compassion I feel. This must have been the same loving rebuke, the same guidance that Jesus offered James and John. It's true, God is angered when we fail to protect the vulnerable, when we fail to receive those in need. The sins of Sodom and of America are real. But the way of Christ is always the way of the cross. For you and for me, it is this call to show compassion, to move closer, to stand with the vulnerable, knowing it means always moving closer to places of hurt, and yes, sometimes to places of danger. With a fragile body in my hands, I stood next to a grieving woman, surrounded by nurses who were with her in her time of greatest need. I prayed and I affirmed the truth that was in this room. Our hope is always found beside the cross. With anxious and angry hearts, James and John looked at the wickedness that was before them, and they wondered out loud, Lord, do you not want us to command fire to come down from heaven and just consume them all? If your heart is filled with despair, if you are angry, you are not alone. And Jesus hears you, and he even affirms that righteousness of your cry. Our God, too, is angered when the people of Sodom or Samaria or America fail to protect the vulnerable. But God's justice does not come through consuming fire. God does not want to punish or to destroy. God's work of justice is to move ever, always towards the cross. We who follow Jesus are called to surrender our comforts and our privileges. We are called to move beyond our anxiety, to move beyond our anger, and to stand with those whose bodies are in very real danger. Do not be afraid to voice your anger or your despair. Do not be afraid to be like James and John. And when you pour out your sorrows, listen. Listen to Christ who calls you ever to the cross, always to this work of compassion. O Lord, in this world of sin and sorrow, your persistent love will not let us go. In the midst of all that we cannot change, your compassion brings comfort. In life and in death, you, O God, never fail to show mercy. And all who follow you are commanded to do the same. Amen. I invite you to stand. Please be seated. United in Christ and guided by the Spirit, we pray for the church, the creation, and all in need. God of faithfulness, soften our hearts and harden our resolve. Move your church to bear your love to the world with courage and conviction. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of gentleness, strengthen the earth's ability to heal. Where there are dangerous storms, bring calm. Where there are destructive fires, bring rain. Protect homes, habitats, and livelihoods threatened by climate disasters. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of peace, guide all who govern, that they place the good of their citizens above self-promotion. Protect refugees and all who live under tyranny or conflict. Open our eyes to suffering in our community and give us endurance in the humble work of justice. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of kindness, reveal your healing presence to all who are sick or dying. Uphold those who grieve. Support the needs of any who are unemployed, hungry, or have nowhere to lay their heads. We pray especially for Sharon, for Marilyn, and for Hank. We pause now to offer up other names of those who need your peace and healing, silently or aloud. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of love, attend to those struggling with addiction, depression, or uncontrolled anger. Provide support systems and loving companions as they work toward health, that they may rest in hope and know the fullness of joy in your presence. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
We now take time to offer up any other prayers, silently or aloud, for what else do the people of God pray? God, on this week when many of our LGBTQ sisters and brothers and siblings celebrate Pride in Minneapolis, we just pray, God, for love, for welcome, for affirmation and inclusion in their lives. And we pray for your church, God, that we would find ways to become more deeply and visibly compassionate. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of joy, we give thanks for all who have died and who now celebrate the inheritance of life in you. Keep their examples of faithfulness always before us, that we trust your promises in life and in death. We pray especially this day for Mary Jo Fisher and all who grieve the death of her husband, Dwayne. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of every time and place, in Jesus' name and filled with your Holy Spirit, we entrust our prayers into your holy keeping. Amen. Time and again, our God reveals that God is a God of abundance and generosity, a God who gives us more than we ask for, more than we can often imagine, if we have senses open to receive it and to be mindful and thankful for it. In the midst of worship, we always take a little time to reflect on generosity. For those who have offerings to share, a reminder, there's a plate on the way in and out, but we're still in these coming out of COVID times where we don't pass the plates. But beyond those monetary gifts, you are also invited just to reflect on the ways that God calls you to be generous with your whole life. And in this time, we receive a musical offering. God of love, you call us beloved children and welcome us to your table. Receive our lives and the gifts we offer. Abide with us and send us in service to a suffering world for the sake of your beloved child, Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen.
This is the table of our Lord, and God invites us to come and be fed. I invite you to join in the celebration of Holy Communion, and I invite you to stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
God of creation, we give you thanks for the wonders of life, the beauty of the world, and the deep and expansive universe of which we are only a small part. We thank you that you have not left us alone in this world. We are blessed with the community of others. We experience your presence and the love we share. And in mysterious ways beyond our abilities to comprehend or to put into words. When the time was right, you sent Jesus to demonstrate your love in new and radical ways. As we gather around this table to share this meal, we remember the great extent of his selfless love and give you thanks in humility and in awe. We add our voices to the chorus of history, who praise you in a multitude of languages and a multitude of songs, forever singing to the glory of your name. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." May these ordinary elements of life, this bread and cup, be transformed by your presence into the body and blood of Christ, nourishing us with spiritual food and equipping us to be the body of Christ in the world. Filled with your Spirit, may we do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with you, loving you with our entire beings and loving others as ourselves. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
To become the
Please be seated. As we turn to sharing communion together, just a reminder, we will have a distribution line in the front. So if you want to come forward and receive Holy Communion, you are invited to do that. I'll offer bread. The communion assistant will offer the trays with individual cups. The outer rings are wine. The clear liquid in the middle is juice. And there is a collection tray just over there on a table where you can put your cup after you consume the wine or juice. If you prefer to stay where you are, you can either use the pre-filled communion cups in the basket in the weigh-in, or I'm happy to come out to you after communion and communion where you're at as well. But you are invited. Let us commune together. body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen. Life-giving God, through this meal you have bandaged our wounds and fed us with your mercy. Now send us forth to live for others, both friend and stranger, that all may come to know your love. This we pray in the name of Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always. I invite you to stand and to share a word or sign of God's peace with one another. I imagine there will come a day when we move around to do the peace again, but I think I'll be a little sad on that day that we look less like a parade. I mean, y'all look kind of, it's great. I love it. We have a time of community announcements in worship. If you have an announcement to share, you are welcome to make your way to the microphone just like Kim is doing. That way all will be able to hear. But yeah, we just take a little time to share what's going on in our life together.
Kathy asked me to make a little announcement. We need volunteers for July Fellowship. There is a sign-up sheet on the table in the narthex. If you can't do the tables and chairs, just sign up to bring the food or sign up to make the coffee. You don't have to do everything, but please, there's like three Sundays in particular in July, the second, third, and fourth Sundays, that need people to volunteer.
All right. Also want to make you aware, of course, that we have fellowship today, right after worship. In fact, it's a little bit cooler down in that air-conditioned space than in here, but there are goodies to share, and we hope you stick around and take advantage of that fellowship time. Also want to make sure you are aware of our summer socials. On the way out on the table, you can find these nice fluorescent-looking summer socials announcement pages. It's also in the first page of your worship folder, so you already have it in your hands. But we have a variety of events. All of these are really designed to help our community grow in fuller relationship, to listen more effectively to our child care center families. We had our first one this last week. We had an ice cream truck out here. It was lovely. And let me just say to you, those young families, they are just kind of hungry for some social. It was lovely to see how they showed up in a large amount, looking for not just ice cream, but a little friendship and love. And so it's a wonderful opportunity for us to come alongside. I know for those of us from the congregation who were there, it was a little easier than you might think. You just kind of find yourself doing the fellowship thing where you wander around and ask people what's up in their life and dote on their children, and it's a lovely time. But we have more of these to come. The next one is this coming Wednesday. For those kind of early risers, it's not that early, but 7:15 to 9 a.m., we're going to have coffee and treats just right out in front of the church. The idea is the child care center families can drop their kiddos off and on the way out either get coffee to go or linger a little bit and just hang out, get to know each other a little bit better and talk. But again, this is for all of us together. So invite you to consider coming to that. All you got to do is show up between 7:15 and 9 out in front of the church. The coffee and treats will be for you as well. So that's a pretty good offer. But hope you participate in those and look for more of those summer socials here in the summer to come. I invite you to stand and to receive God's blessing. The God of peace, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you, comfort you, and show you the path of life this day and always. Amen.
Thank you. in peace, love your neighbor.
Thanks be to God.